I am here today with a special guest. I'm here with Laura Eisenhower. Laura, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm doing good. For those of you who don't know who Laura is, she is she's the great granddaughter of Dwight Eisenhower, correct? Okay, she's an ascension coach, an alchemist, and a public speaker, and she strives to raise love vibration and the importance to pretty much get that out to people. Laura, I got to tell you, I have a lot of people who have a lot of questions for you.
That's awesome.
Okay, so one of the questions that I have is kind of to jump into things. People want to know what happens when we pass away. Like, what is your opinion on when we die?
Well, I mean, that's an interesting one because there is kind of like a light in the tunnel that kind of sends us right back. And it's kind of difficult, and it has been for the last, I guess, 26,000 years or so to sort of move on from this particular planetary experience in a sort of 3D level. I mean, we're on an ascension planet, though, so that's reassuring. But just to kind of cover the weird stuff first, then I'll kind of go into the other thing.
Okay.
It's almost like we're being rerouted, and we're sort of lost in this time loop going, you know, through reincarnation cycles and incarnation cycles. And for a lot of people, it's kind of a commitment or a contract for 26,000 years to assist the planet. And humanity to kind of wake up to what the organic ascension timeline is all about. And those that aren't really aware or understanding of it, I mean, people like John Lash, you know, and others who speak about what happens after life, from the sort of perspective of archons and, you know, lower creator gods and manipulations, it is sort of a false experience from what they say. And because we get rerouted, and we should be able to move on.
Right.
But, you know, there's a mixture of, you know, things that are a part of our own soul contract and then things that, you know, we're having to contend with that, you know, are kind of alien machinery and technology that we can rise above and override. But there are souls that, you know, don't get caught up in all that, so seems that they, I mean, there's all kind of, you know, experiences. I have to say that I went through a life-death experience, and I've come close to death so many times that it's sort of a good question for me, but I experienced it sort of within a physical body where I went through the whole cycle of death and came back into the physical body, and basically I left my body and barely any of me was in my body for maybe about 15 years or so. Maybe even more. I went to a clairvoyant institute and told me that this was what had happened, and I knew it because I was writing a book about it, that I actually, like, survived, you know, going through a death cycle and coming back to my body without losing the physical body. And they used to do this in ancient times to kind of have mastery over death. So there's, you know, that kind of scenario where, you know, a person can, you know, experience death and death cycles while still in the physical body. And then there's, you know, the ability to move beyond kind of like the astral realms of where maybe there's false light that reroutes us back, you know, based more on, you know, programming. But the experience of, you know, a soul going beyond that and maybe still making the choice to come back, you know, maybe to be a light worker, maybe to take, you know, earth incarnations. For some of us, you know, decide to just come here and do work. And they go beyond and into, like, the ethers and into what's called Akasa. And there's also I mean, what I'm sensing, we sort of go back into the blueprint of the Divine Trinity and somehow get purified and get returned again if we're able to bypass and move beyond the astral stuff. And so when we hear about people having a life-death experience, you know, you almost have to just put your strongest intuition on and ask yourself, okay, is this sort of an archonic story where a person's coming back and being rerouted to incarnate again, and one can tell that that individual is unconscious, but it's still a catalyst for a great awakening that might help them to achieve going to the higher level. You know, it just really is a case-by-case basis. We have the seven heavens, beneath this veil that are the seven heavens, connected to the demiurge and the archons. And then beyond that, and above that, there's much more. And we have chakras that connect us to much more. And we need to understand that, depending on the vibratory rate of the soul and what they experience here, kind of determines whether they're going to stay kind of stuck in the seven heavens, which I wouldn't say is terrible, but it is connected to, still being in a world of duality and not achieving the completion that I think many souls want to complete. And then there's going beyond that and either staying there or making the choice to come back and help the human race.
Wow.
And that's all I can really say. There's always that life review. I've had tons of life reviews. I feel like I have one at least once a week, and I'm like, okay, am I going to die? It's that process, everything all the time.
Right.
It depends, on a person's chart, too. Do they have a lot of Scorpio and Pluto, which is the planet of death and rebirth? And sometimes people, like I said, can keep the physical body here, and sometimes their physical body can't stand it, and they have a life review, and their physical body needs to go, and they need to come back for a new experience. Or, like I said, they graduated, they don't need to come back, but a lot of being choose to in their contract is true.
Sure, and, there's so much to cover. in 1 hour, it's like, wow, because I really know from my own personal beliefs that it's not even a rabbit hole, just reality as we know it is just, wow, it's just so much going on. I kind of wonder sometimes, Laura, if we even, I don't really want to touch base on a lot of negativity on the show tonight, because that's one thing that I really didn't want to do. But in order for people to understand what's going on, I'm just going to talk a little bit about negative stuff. Really, when we look at like alien abductions, or we look at like, personally, I don't think all reptilians are evil, but when we look at, the control over the soul recycling, do the archons or any negative entities have control over us being recycled? And if so, is there an escape? I think it's raising your vibration. But I mean, do they have us on lockdown, like a prison planet lockdown, or no?
So you're asking if that part of it, do they have like a grip on and control over?
Yeah, yeah.
And it's fun too. I mean, we have to understand that there's beings from the future, there's beings from all over, the galaxy. There's all sorts of beings that are on this earth that aren't all, human. And there's a lot of interesting hybrids and, interesting genetics walking around. And I know that abduction scenarios have a lot to do with trapping people in what they need to have a life cycle and to sort of maintain a life cycle, because they end up dying out after a certain point and come back to abduct to get genetic material so that they don't die out for good. And there's certain technologies that they use also to siphon energies from us, but everything from abduction to certain technologies are what helps them to keep a life cycle alive. And their life cycle is based on wanting control, so they're not connected to spirit, and mm-hmm. they're not on an ascension path because they want to control the matrix and save humanity. So of course they're not, connected to their divine essence anymore. And so their future selves, are a part of using this technology to kind of go back and it's like, it's sort of an artificial immortality. And, we see creatures in the web of life and just in nature that have a, sort of a life cycle and a lifespan. And there's some lower ET races that, die out in 45,000 or 52,000 years. And they're not ascended beings, And, I have absolute hope. I have no fear about the future. You can't tell me anything and have me go into panic mode and fear mode. Pretty much also because I've been at this for thousands and thousands of years. I've gotten plenty of readings about it. Same with them. They've been trying to create artificial timelines, and lots of beings have been maintaining and preserving the organic ascension timeline, because this is an ascension planet. So we just have to recognize that right now we're seeing a lot of timelines crisscross, and we're witnessing all sorts of things, and we don't necessarily know where we are on the map. And the best thing that we can do is to understand that, we're really here for soul development and spiritual development. And when we get locked up in, the hidden agendas and the dark agendas, most of the time, it's, people that are unconscious that do. And the ones that are conscious that do, are part of, you know, the ones that have made agreements with ETs that have the life cycle I'm talking about that don't end up ascending. And so the unconscious humans, yes, we worry about them. But at the same time, you know, we all have, you know, soul memories and different memories from, you know, lifetimes that we took, you know, in different star systems and in the future timelines, you know, in this planetary sphere. And I know that, you know, these souls aren't going to be abandoned. You know, I feel I'm going to make it. I know I'm going to make it because I don't want to go into, like, what I represent and what I've done and where I am in the galactic scheme of things. But, you know, I'm reassured by the fact that I'm not going to allow souls to be trapped and enslaved. And I know that there's many higher dimensional beings and a lot of souls on this earth that are in agreement to that. So if we do move on, this place isn't going to be abandoned, and the souls that are here aren't going to be abandoned. And it's going to take a lot of rescuing of the souls that have been siphoned and used and almost, you know, taken from the person. And, you know, this is a person that hasn't been self-possessed, for, you know, to begin with. And so how can we protect ourselves? We need to know ourselves, understand ourselves, be grounded in our soul energy, unplug ourselves from the matrix, recognize, you know, just what game is being played. And I think everybody needs to check themselves for implants and, you know, really look at it, you know, these times as, which road are we going to go down? And why would we go down a road we don't want to go? And what are all the things we need to watch out for to avoid that? It's everything from, you know, making sure we don't have implants to, you know, watching, you know, GMOs and put in our bodies and the vibratory rate, exactly what you're saying. I think the most important thing is paying attention to how we are the minute we wake up and the minute we fall asleep and be conscious. If we can just be conscious in every moment, you know, the words we speak, the thoughts we have, and, you know, the health and quality of the relationships we have, and we make a commitment to maintain balance and, you know, a level of expansion and goodwill and harmony and mutual respect, our vibration continues to increase, you know, and there's a lot of attacks and assaults that are trying to throw us into lower behavior. We watch the news and all of a sudden our vibration changes.
Well, that, yeah, absolutely. Not to cut you off, but that's one thing I really wanted to touch base on myself. I mean, being so involved in activism that I am, luckily, and I mean luckily, you know, I mean, I've seen other dimensional beings, the big boogeyman, brown, gray reptilian, I've seen them, full manifestation, and, you know, I wasn't afraid, but I think when I started raising my vibration, and not only representing humanity, but representing everyone who is existing in our existence, that's when things really started opening up for me, doors really started opening up for me, and other beings, you know, that are, you know, advanced mentally wise, you know, said, hey, look, we'll help you, you know, show you other ways to help you help other people. And, you know, I kind of think like, all right, are there chemtrails? Yes. Are there GMOs in our food? Yes. You know, is there like the big boogeyman, New World Order, Illuminati people? Yes. But sometimes I wonder, and maybe it's just me, but I kind of think that they throw all this crap at us to keep us in a state of, like, fight, 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 low vibrational frequencies, low vibrational ways of thinking, so that way we don't ascend?
Of course. That's exactly why these agendas are happening.
Yeah.
I don't want to cut you off, but if you had more to share on that.
Well, I mean, not to throw any names out there, because I'm not going to do that, but there's certain big-time talk hosts that's just like, you know, FEMA. I mean, look, maybe that is their agenda, but I think that when we realize that there's no such thing as death and that we're all energy, you know, I kind of like, you know, you kind of get the same way that negative beings can program stuff into you or download stuff into you, positive beings can do the same thing. Okay. You know what I'm saying? So I think that what I'm getting is that they're doing this on purpose because we're at a certain timeline, I think, to where it's kind of either shake it or make it, or you're going to be, you know, you're not going to make it. And I think that they all know this. And I think that's why certain movies are thrown out to get in our subconscious. That's why certain games are put out, like Grand Theft Auto, for instance, to get in our subconsciously. We're making these actions, but we don't understand that it affects us. And I think that there's a big plan to kind of harvest and keep as many people from moving on as possible, or what do you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, we're in a stellar activation cycle. The natural stargates are opening. We're in a place in the cosmos right now, as far as where the planetary body has moved into, where we're getting major downloads, and we're able to really advance ourselves and have our DNA upgraded, and it's you know time to make contact. And we don't want to move into a transhumanism world, so we need to like start focusing on the contact we can make and start to work with the benevolent races so that they can help us deal with, you know, what's going on with these ET government treaties. For the most part, you know, a conscious and awake person is on the right path, and they can counteract all of this. You have to really buy into the programming that is fed in the media. You have to really fall for the false flags and all the different programming connected to the masculine and feminine to stay in a low density, because the vibrations are low, and it's not really our truth. It's not, you know, connecting to our divine blueprint or to Gaia. It's really just teaching us to be addicted to the artificial matrix, where, yes, we're going to be affected by chemtrails and everything that they're, you know, assaulting us with. And, yes, the whole point is that they don't want us to ascend, but this planet is naturally taking us in that direction. Right. Even with all of this geoengineering and weather modification and mind control, we have to realize the stellar activation cycle and this a window period we're in, where we can really steer things and get things, you know, back on track, is peaking right now, and it'll start to decline in 2017. So I'm doing everything I can to just awaken people, you know, to the truth of what they're made of, and just, you know, do missions and all sorts of things to, you know, really get people involved in going to police departments and being friendly with the police and telling them what's going on behind the scenes and telling them what we're up against.
Right.
Without all protesting, because if we do the protest, then we're basically saying it's us against them, we're in duality, and we need to fight and battle.
Right.
And I'm not, you know, putting anybody down if they do protest, but if we can engage people with integrity, you know, like the police force, and just, you know, come from, you know, a place of I'm a concerned citizen, or I'm a parent, or, you know, I've got information, you know, about this politician or this person that is illegal and criminal. What can we do as a, you know, what can we do to stop this? Because none of this should be voted in. It needs to be held accountable. And so this is the greatest opportunity right now to, you know, decide what we're going to do. And we can steer anything at this moment. And then it's going to get a little bit difficult 4 or 5 years from now. And you have to really want it, you know. There's a lot of people that don't care. You know, they get mad at people like you and me for the information we put out there. They don't long, you know, for a better world and a higher world. They're absolutely addicted to everything that gets thrown at us. And they're actually also locked into, you know, the destruction as well as, you know, whatever turns on the serotonin temporarily. And we have to understand that our DNA is linked to the stargates on the planet. And so as they try and dumb us down even more with, you know, chemtrails, it affects the stargates and their ability to open. And so everything right now is just at a critical place. And
right. The
ascension is happening, but it's kind of like as best you're going to miss if you're distracted and lost in the matrix programming. And this is, you know, why it's actually really easy for us to be okay and get on track and not go into FEMA camps. But if we don't act now, we're going to be looking back and we're going to wish that we did more. Because
yeah.
This is the only chance. We have a lot of freedom still right now. And if we vote for people like Hillary Clinton and Jeff Bush or any of these folks, we basically signed a paper saying, I'm okay with New World Order. And another part of what I'm trying to do is educate people about what these people are really about and what is going on behind the scenes, even though it's kind of dangerous to do that. Because
mm-hmm.
this is what people need to know. Anyway,
mm-hmm.
yes, we're ascending, and they want to stop it. And
right.
these agendas have been in the works for a long time, where technologies were actually put in place just 26,000 years ago to make this period of time very difficult for us.
Well, I mean, behind the scenes, they're all child-sacrificing energy parasites, you know, I mean, and it's all energy, and that's the thing. It's very hard for me to get into the conscious mind of activists because, you know, when people just wake up, they're thinking, well, I'm just waking up to corruption, I'm just waking up to the New World Order, but really, that's just a fraction of what's really going on, and this is a war. It's an energy war. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. And the thing is, you know, awakening isn't knowing all the conspiracies or, you know, understanding the games being played. Really, truly awakening is understanding, you know, how the heart bridges heaven and earth, you know, how our heart energy is, you know, the greatest power that we can utilize to offset all this stuff because of the vibration that it is. I mean, it is a frequency battle, and we have the upper hand because, you know, we can reach way beyond the lower vibrations of these technologies and these lower races. But we need to do it before our bodies are so damaged by everything that we're being assaulted with.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because we can create alchemy and actually transmute all of it, you know. But a lot of people that are unconscious won't be able to easily. So they need to just really, like, I hate to say it, listen to people like us and, you know, take measures that'll protect them because, you know, this isn't a doom or gloom scenario. This is about choice. And this is about understanding our options and knowing, you know, you can get implants removed. You can, you know, transmute some of the stuff that's, you know, going on and get deprogrammings and do things to protect yourself so that your vibration can continue to increase in these times and not sink. And it's really not as bad as it all looks, but, you know, we're being pushed to the edge, and being pushed to the edge is a major catalyst for awakening. And what I do is I look at the chemtrails and I look at everything that, you know, would bring most people down, and I say, I'm going to let that be a tool to empower me. I'm going to let it remind me of what they want to stop, which is us, because we're powerful beings. And so I let it empower me, and I let it strengthen me, and I let it do something wonderful instead of bring me down. And you know, if we can just turn the weapons they throw at us into something that serves us, then it's no longer a weapon, and it loses the momentum of, you know, the destruction that they wish it to cause. And we kind of outsmart them at their own game. And I think we just need to do that. But most people are still, like, in the very beginning, trying to accept that there might be ETs and accepting the fact that, you know, the government would do this to us. And I have to say I have a tremendous amount of compassion, but the rudeness and the insults that people throw, you know, I know there's a lot of trolls, but I mean, come on, people, like, it's real obvious what's going on here. And I can understand that, you know, the Illuminati stuff and the rituals is really difficult, you know, to understand, but when you unplug from source and you're no longer connected to it, there's nothing left but to be a parasite and a vampiric type being. And they need technology to fight them energy, and that's all they've got, you know, and we're better than that. And we can completely override all of this because it is very low. There's so many higher dimensions that we can access right now within our own bodies. And we just, we got to, you know, start to speed up and accelerate the process because it is sort of like who's going to get to the finish line first when the stellar activation cycle starts to decline.
Well, you know, it's again, like you said, you know, you have compassion for those who don't understand what's going on, and I have I feel the same way. But those who are shown the truth and not only refuse to empower themselves to empower other people, but go ahead and criticize and, you know, belittle people who are actually trying to be positive. They're the people I just, like, have no respect for whatsoever. You know?
Yeah, I address those people a lot, and I'm putting out videos about it, and just, you know, really, like, come on, people, like, you're basically, like, committing your own suicide for any of your freedoms to be granted to you. You know, it's, like, such a low energy, and, you know, mutual respect and unification is everything right now, and so many people are missing the mark, and I'm shocked at how little a lot of people have progressed. I mean, and it's just amazing how for some people, it's easy, and they get the download, they wake up, they get the synchronicities to align the things that really help them to see the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And other people, it's immature, they don't care, they're ungrateful brats, they don't appreciate people like you and me that put our life on the line.
Or they have the ego, or what they do is when they wake up to the truth, they have the ego, because a lot of the people in the truth movement, and I'm not going to bullshit it, you know, the truth movement's become a reality TV show. Who can be the coolest? Who can, you know, it's like ridiculous. Early in my career, I had the ego problem at first. You know, I'm not going to lie about it. Of course I did. And I was very angry when it took a lot for me to, you know, embrace different beings with love. Because when you're constantly thrown negativity, like, well, they're eating this person and doing this and doing that, you're like, you know, you're like, wow, you're like, this is some, we're in an all-out war, and it really isn't like that, you know what I mean? So I believe there's different stages that people go through when they first, if you want to call it, like you said, when they're downloaded with information, and it was rough, it was rough for me, but, you know, just thank the creators that I'm able to do what I do, what little I do, and, you know, another question is, you ever, well, I'm sure you've heard of this, about the what is it, the Illyrian Wars, I think it is? Not to get too much into that, because that'll take up a lot of time on that, but have you ever heard of the cat species, the cat race? No one seems to want to talk about them, Laura. No one. As soon as I bring them up, it's just lights out.
I've had them come to me
three different times.
Nice.
I don't have no idea who they are. They walked me to a altar, it looked like, with blue flames. At the time I thought, this is right when my abductions had stopped. And I thought, oh my god, I'm being abducted again. And I seen like this feline looking race, tall, white looking, you know, they were taking me and showing me to another one. There was two of them that took me, and I seen a tall one. And he just looked at me and vanished. And I was just like, I'm under the impression that I wasn't ready yet. That I like, it's kind of like, let's throw him into the mix and see what he's made. What can he do? I mean, when I try to talk to people about this race, no one knows anything other than what they, you know, hear on the internet. Any insight on them?
I would think that they would be connected to, like, the feline, you know, the lion people. And it's all kind of like the cat family. the Byron feline really do want to interact with us. And, mm-hmm. you know, when we think of the Byron star system, it was under attack quite a bit. And when star systems are under attack, it means that, you know, people are, you know, whatever beings, if their home planet was destroyed, I mean, they're basically, you know, sort of wanderers. And that's actually what happened in the beginnings of, you know, our galactic history in terms of how it ended up creating this sort of planetary body that we're on right now and the necessity of a planetary body like this coming about. But a lot of displaced beings in the cosmos, I mean, even the Anunnaki considered, you know, displaced, you know, but they're more like on a pirate ship, you know, kind of, you know, doing things that are all about, you know, misuse of power, you know, dark pirates, you know, some pirates aren't.
Right.
Real dark. And, like, the Lyra and Feline, so, they like to interact with us because what I'm getting, is they were somewhat displaced too, and, you know, they made a new home for themselves, but when the founder race defeated, you know, humans in the time matrix, you know, lots of different beings, you know, were involved, and so there's a lot of interaction happening to, you know, sort of protect us and keep up with us and make sure that we're okay. And they, you know, many beings consider us our family, particularly if there's, you know, DNA compatibility. I wouldn't say the whole human race has, you know, the feline lion, you know, family, but I think, you know, anybody who makes contact with them is carrying some of their DNA and has made relationships with them before and been in, you know, maybe that particular star system before they were displaced and maybe, you know, went to a new location with them. But there are a lot of races interacting with us because of that displacement and also because they feel a responsibility to us because of the DNA connection. And there's a lot of, you know, that feeling of galactic family. You know, there are a lot of things that we're able to recreate, you know, home base, but, you know, the ones that, you know, visit, I wouldn't say they're homeless, but, kind of like acting as spirit guides and making themselves available and not right. really, you know, living in existence like we don't exist. And so they're sort of like, you know, like if you lose, you know, a family member and that spirit is still hanging around. There's ancient races that are like that. And there's, you know, it's a different sort of dynamic and context than other ancient races, but that's what I'm getting from the lion people.
Right.
For the cat races and everything that you were talking about.
Right. Well, I mean, we can get into the Sphinx and the Sphinx on Mars and other different things like that, but I'm not going to dabble in that right now. Another thing is, well, you talked a little about time traveling and how there's different dimensions and people from the future, people from the past, and I try to really, you know, tell people that. People say, well, what does it matter what we do now, because in another existence right now, this isn't going on, it's peaceful, or in another dimensional reality right now, you know, this isn't going on because... It's totally apocalyptic scenario, and you know, I mean, what do you think? I mean, it doesn't matter if there's different time, you know, traveling futuristic events and dimensions everywhere? Does it matter if we protest? Does it matter if we try to bring love vibration? Because there's other, you know, there's we can obviously go back to, from the past to the future to the past to the future. So, I mean, does what we do right now matter?
I mean, that's a good question because, you know, at a certain point, it's just like, is there any point in looking back or looking at our history because it's been so tampered with? And so,
right.
You know, I think it matters as far as where we decide we're going to direct our energy. And, I mean, I think it's also important to disclose the fact that technology exists, which, you know, folks like me and Andrew Bisharla and others that, you know, have been exposed to it. I wasn't in the project like my colleagues and friends, but I was recruited. And I was pre-targeted, before birth, and the project that they were in told me about this. You know, so I just kind of have a different, you know, story going on. And I'm at a point where, I mean, it's very complicated. And one good example is, you know, the Second World War. You know, the history about that keeps changing. You know, people will say the Holocaust never happened, or, you know, Eisenhower did this or that he never heard that he did, or, you know, Hitler was actually a good guy. And we have to understand that after Project Paperclip and after the infiltration of, you know, even the Mars agenda and different, you know, things that, you know, were really for our defense, even though it was a secrecy, it's all been infiltrated. It's all been sort of messed up to the point where we can't look back on our history and trust that anything is really true, because if you can go back and alter documents and use clone bodies to set up a scenario that you can take a picture of and then, you know, place somewhere that is going to be a part of a particular timeline, you know, I encourage people to let's forget about history and start to just look at the technologies and look at the games that's being played and make that our education and interest, because the rest of it, you know, it at this point it's a moot point because there's too much ability to, you know, mess with things. And, you know, we're also dealing with, you know, how they have tried to prevent future scenarios from happening that would be a benefit by targeting the individuals that could bring it about. And I think we need to worry a lot more about the obstacles that are in front of us rather than the manipulations that are absolutely rewriting our history, because that's a bigger battle to fight, and it's the past. Let's protect our future and, you know, at least get a grip on what these technologies are, because then it'll cover all territory. You know, the time travel manipulations that have got into our history and how certain technologies have been utilized so that they can stop different things from happening, you know, or reroute humanity away from the organic ascension timeline by setting up an Armageddon scenario based on using technologies to create superstorms or to create, you know, superviruses or to create, you know, all sorts of things that make us think that, you know, this is actually just what, you know, what the future is, and we can't really prevent it. Well, we have to, you know, get a grip on the manipulation in these times much more than, you know, try and, you know, just exist as humans as we used to exist as. And the more I think we expose the technologies, the better off we are, because these technologies could be used to feed those in need. You know, the teleportation could be sending supplies, you know, and you know, helping people. We have ways to clean up the environment, and there's no excuse for them hoarding it and creating all the destruction that they're creating. And there's no excuse for people not having food. And the elitists, you know, are creating a breakaway civilization on Mars and are going to leave us here while they, you know, create this new world order. And I think our priority needs to be all about stopping it. And the thing is, they rewrote history and they are attempting to so that we walk right into their trap by getting lost in, you know, just the scenarios that just keep us in a historical resentment about who did what to what ancestor. It's like, we got to understand, you know, the Illuminati and the puppet masters behind the scenes and just drop, you know, being humans as we think we should be. And the social engineering and the conditioning, you know, from our history doesn't matter anymore. We have to clear ourselves and purify ourselves and be prepared for what's in front of us. I think that's where it's at.
Well, I have another question about what someone thinks. This is from Dan. He wants to know, is Planet X Nibiru coming by, and is that why the parasites are hiding in their underground bases? And is that why they have to, I hate when I stutter, their teleportations to Mars and stuff like that? So basically the question is, Planet X, is it real? Is it coming? And is that why they have underground bases?
I've done so much research on this, and nothing, I mean, everybody has something different to say to the point of it's just like, oh my gosh. The biggest source of information I trust the most of is in quantum science, mm-hmm. And also Lisa Renee and her work. And so You know, Nibiru's been compromised, and it was compromised a long time ago. And basically, it's a chunk of an exploded planet that became the asteroid belt from our ancient history. And, you know, yes, the Anunnaki, you know, and that crew, you know, have been riding it. And so, yes, you know, there's a chance that these, you know, lower creator gods might show up again. And the thing is, you know, our DNA and its potential can get us up to speed with where they are at. And we can advance ourselves pretty rapidly so that when they do and maybe do show up, you know, we're prepared and we're not, you know, these dumbed down humans. We're actually, we did the work we need to do to upgrade our DNA, we cleared up the implants, and we paid attention to the things that are trying to compromise us. So that if the Anunnaki and the Nibiru planet does show up, they're going to have to greet people that are even on their level and beyond, because that's how the human race was seeded. That's why they've been, you know, very upset, because they compromised their DNA a long time ago to control the time matrix. And then the angelic human was seeded with greater potential than that, and they realized that we're going to have to try and enslave the divine human so that we don't usurp them in power. And this is what game is being played. So we have to understand we're way more powerful than them. And if we could just focus on advancing ourselves and our spiritual abilities, who cares if they show up? I mean, we inherited their archetypal dramas anyway.
Right.
And, you know, we're a huge part of them. And they're like our false creator parents, but we still have a lot of their characteristics. And they are, to me, the veil. Once we lift the veil and we understand our true source, that's when we actually defeat them, because they don't want us to achieve that. And
right.
The whole Genesis story and a lot of the focus on certain God forms have kept us from just connecting to our own divine blueprint and our own potential. And this is the game that's being played in religion, but it's also in the New Age, with all the New Age perceptions and the false teachings and so many programmings that are connected to the New Age. You know,
what you're talking about, the Galactic Federation of Light, who I'm not even allowed to post, or any of my friends are not allowed to post any of my work in their group. If any of my work is posted in their group, they're automatically banned. But yeah, they're called the Galactic Federation of Light, Lightbringers. Is that who you're talking about? These New Age, these deceivers.
No, more humans that are distorting teachings, that are receiving programmings from different dimensional locations and posts that kind of alien machinery that projects certain programming that compromise their kundalini. And it's basically, you know, people that are misusing power. What you're talking about, is a part of, you know, I mean, we've been in galactic wars for so long, and, you know, federations have had to be created to protect our interests. You know, some, you know, get infiltrated, and some, you know, individuals and maybe groupings and factions amongst them can get corrupt. But we have to just check ourselves. You know, we can be connected to all those things that you mentioned and be a very different being than maybe somebody that was a part of it and kind of, you know, lost themselves or got caught up in negative ego patterning. We don't really need to worry about anybody but ourselves right now. And then that vibratory frequency that we hold is going to help us to link to our soul family and our star family that, you know, is on the same page as us. But sometimes it's going to be in huge federations that have kind of a mixed bag. And, you know, we can't stop certain corruptions from happening. But what I'm getting is you're not connected to the corrupted aspect. You're a major champion of, you know, really getting things on track. But there are some beings that sort of lost what you're upholding. And that federation is very big, what you're talking about. But on Earth, I'm talking about the people that are susceptible to, you know, direct, you know, false teachings and just how they're passing them on to other humans. And, you know, some, yeah, false channelings and even channelings of ascended masters that are false, that are promoting the programming that, you know, come in the form of, like, looping technology. When we deal with the real deal stuff, though, it's a whole other thing. And that's why if we can just, you know, get out of the group mind and figure out who we are,
right,
and then re-enter the group mind, then we can't be fooled and we have, you know, discernment that's working for us. We don't have to join in with any federation and lead ourselves. You know, we can become leaders.
Right.
And we can call things out. And I see that you've got that ability, that you're, you know, you're not one to be a follower, and you have a huge role in things that might have been around for a while, but it doesn't mean that you give your power away. I mean, you're a leader in these groupings, and even though you're in a human body right now, you've got direct connection. It seems that you telepath with some of the higher beings that are part of these federations that are trying to help us.
Sure. I mean, one of the, again, you know, I had one of the talls, I don't know what you call them, Zetas. They manifested themselves in in my apartment. Next thing I know, these two huge cat-like things showed up, and it vanished like it ran. After that, I've had no problems with as far as it being abducted. Now, the only other thing I've had where I've had negative beings like try me, test me, if you want to call it that. You want to call them shadow people when you're asleep. You know, most people get that sleep paralysis and you can see the shadows around you, and you know, it's kind of like they want to come after you. And this is going to sound insane, but people who are awake understand, there's such a thing called astral magic. If you look at Star Wars, it's called a force push. You know what I'm saying, or no? It's called a force push where you take energy and throw it. And as that had happened to me, you know, I couldn't move, and the next thing I knew, I picked up on it. You know, I force pushed, and as soon as I did that, I jumped up, and they vanished. They're they're cowards, and that just goes to show when we're really awakened and we really understand how different things work, energy works, basically, that we have a pretty good chance. And again, to I never really followed anyone. I kind of if someone's going left, I want to go right, because usually when a group of people are going left, there's something, you know, there's something hidden, you know, on the other side. So, I kind of like my style like that. But I think one of the most important things I've learned, and one of the things that I respect that you do, is, you know, really push, no matter what's happening, the importance of love vibration. You know, at every protest I've ever went to, I've always hugged people and said, listen, you know, go home, hug your family, you know, be as positive as you can, even though things are kind of shitty, you know?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we're having a really weird experience, but we're, you know, infinite beings. We've been around a long time, and we're not really going anywhere. And, yeah, none of us wants to be enslaved here or trapped here. And, and there's so many people with callings, and there's so many people that have signed up to get the wake-up call that they need. You know, we think about a lot before we incarnate into these bodies. There's a lot of agreements, you know, that we make, and contracts, and there's a necessity for that.
Well, how come we can't remember these contracts that we made? Isn't that kind of unfair that we can't remember them? You know, like,
everything's unfair, and I love to just kind of hit that point home without sounding like I'm explaining. If we're in a world of, you know, experiencing the tree of good and evil, you know, the tree of knowledge, you know, get the freaking mind control off everybody and let them have real experiences and figure things out. Mm-hmm. And that's number one. And then the other thing is, we don't really remember our contract. Sometimes it can take, you know, up to, like, you know, I mean, decades and decades of our lives to just have a revelation to remember, you know, why we're here and what our purpose is. That's what I do when I do readings for people. I help them to find those agreements so they can accelerate down their spiritual and life purpose path. And the reason is that our DNA, you know, has been compromised. We're in a world of duality where there is a splitting between our higher and lower self. And some people might say, oh, I don't like the way she puts that, higher and lower self. But
well, who cares what they like?
If we're functioning at 2-3-strand DNA level, but we used to be 12-strand and beyond, and dealing with frequency fences in our DNA, and we're dealing with, you know, chemtrails and, you know, a veil that separates us from true source, you know, it's going to be difficult for us to remember certain things, but the contracts are in connection to this, because most of the contracts have to do with, you know, dismantling this stuff and removing the frequency fences and lifting the veil. So it's kind of funny, we start off not remembering, but when we do remember, you know, we take care of all the things that initially cause the amnesia. So we're going to take care of, like, so many different things, and when we put all the different columns together, it's like a puzzle piece that I think is going to cover a lot of territory. And it's very difficult, even though we have amnesia, it's very difficult maybe to wake that up, but it's even more difficult, I think, to not hear what your inner calling is and purpose is if you came in with one. You know, eventually you're going to hear it. Eventually it's going to get obvious and clear. And even though it might not be obvious right away, and there might be distractions that take you off, you know, away from, you know, your path, if the contract is strong enough and your mission and purpose is important enough, there's all sorts of protection and all sorts of forces that are going to make sure that you don't get away with, you know, getting lost and getting, you know, going down a path that is far, far away from, you know, what your true purpose is. That's why people manifest crises, injuries, that's why relationships break up, because really it gives us the opportunity to look at, you know, what's in front of us, you know, what who are we really? Because when something has to leave or some sort of crisis happens, we're pulled into ourselves and we start to really analyze things. And then we do the inner work and we go on a dark night of the soul journey. And that's when we don't have time to pay attention to the programming, because we're too busy, you know, discovering, you know, how much, you know, we do have emotions and we care, you know, and especially when there's loss. And crisis, you know, always helps people to realize, you know, that they're not invincible, that their ego and whatever illusions it's created is not really where the truth is at. And the universe and different forces out there are sometimes going to kick our butt, you know, so that we will wake up. And so I think a lot of people have had that happen, and that's why they're awake today. And all the different people that we see that are unconscious might have that on their path. It's just not happened yet, you know, and we're all moving at different speeds. But, you know, the chances that a lot of humans will be, you know...
We don't have a lot of time left, and a lot of them are going to be left behind. It's just that simple. Well, not left behind, but recycled.
Yeah, you know, and the thing is that if you lose connection with Source, you're either going to need technology to keep you alive, to keep yourself in a life cycle, or you return to space dust, you know, and, you know, we can make all the choices right now to decide if that's the path that we want. And so the people that come on YouTube and insult or put people down or just are in a low vibration, you know, you're not really hurting us. It's kind of like a joke at this point. You're really hurting yourself, you know. It's kind of entertainment, you know. It's like, have at it, you know. You're not going to stop our mission.
You can knock on the ear, yeah.
You're really screwing yourself over is what I tell them, you know.
Pretty much.
You're not really hurting my feelings, but I'm kind of feeling sorry for you because you're screwing yourself over, and you're basically allowing your soul to be owned by the dark side, and you know.
Tell the truth. You have to speak about it, right, and that's the truth. You know, you're like the princess warrior, you know, so, and that's what I love about it, because you're battle-tested, battle-hardened, and you're still bringing love vibration, and that's what it's all about. So people can say whatever they want. People can say, oh, Paul's a Lizzie, he's not really human, or this, or that, or that, or this. You know, you're going to get hit with everything. I don't give a shit if you're red, yellow, green, white, whatever. It's not about that. It's about what the hell are you doing right now to make it happen. I found that out. Me and my daughter, we were shopping, and I found a loaf of bread, okay? And obviously the mouse had gotten the bread. And these little guys like, well, it's not my problem. Take it to the office. So I knock on the door, and I took it to the office, and you can see the manager or whatever he was, his face was completely shape-shifted. And I said, excuse me, sir. And he said, yes. I said, look, man, mouse has been in this bread. Can you throw it away? And he knew I seen him. And I didn't even say nothing. Now, that's what it's all about. You understand? It's about when you see through the illusion, when your mind mentally can see through the matrix, if you want to call it that, how are you going to handle it? Are you going to flip out and automatically want to grab your gun and start? You know what I mean? Or are you going to say, hey, look, no matter who you are, no matter where you're from, let's handle this shit together. You know what I mean? Because this planet, as hollow as it is, you know, it's for everyone to live on.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah. I mean, how do you feel about that?
Well, it's the teamwork, it's the unity consciousness, and the thing is, you know, we can't just all come together and unify if we're going to unify on sort of old paradigm principles of, you know, like not understanding how the masculine and feminine should be relating. And it's not so much about the outer gender, it's understanding that we have masculine and feminine, and everybody has both. And we have to learn how to, you know, connect with it and bring it into balance. You know, there's a lot that we need to do before we're ready to unify. We need to embrace our uniqueness, our authenticity. We have to understand that we're like a web of life, just like nature, and we're not all going to be the same. We're not meant to be the same. You know, a dolphin does not go through a crisis about whether it should, you know, have been a squirrel. You know, it's not going to try and become a squirrel. It's going to stay a dolphin, and, you know, whatever. It's like diversity and harmony is oneness, and we tend to think that oneness is giving up, you know, our power or joining some new age cult, or oneness is new world order. We have to understand that real oneness is diversity and harmony connecting to, you know, a one source that we're all linked to. Mm-hmm. And that's going to make our planetary body healthy, because our Earth responds to us. And she chose it to be that way so that she can help teach us where we're going wrong. And it's a very difficult path because we're dealing with mind control, we're dealing with, you know, the cabal, we're dealing with hidden technologies. But, you know, there's great strength in the things that challenge us. And, you know, that's what builds, you know, superhuman on an organic level, not on a, you know, Nazi, you know, eugenics and all the different master plans they have to, you know, dominate and control. So, you know, everything that's organic is being mimicked and basically sort of taken over, like the architecture and blueprint is, you know, being utilized, but there's some things that they can't get their hands on that have to do with spirit. And,
yeah.
And that's going to win in the end.
Yeah, and I was thinking the same thing with what the chemtrails are doing to Mother Earth with the trees. And you ever see the trees, especially in Cali, how they have bark is all white and it's just eating up the trees and the forest fires because of, you know, the way how dry it and hot it is with the spraying. And it's kind of like they're trying to just artificial everything. They just don't want spirit. They you know, because they're so soulless and dead. You know, they don't want spirit. A real quick other question I have. If there are reptilians or tall whites or any other beings that are on this planet, why aren't they helping, you know, they have to live here too, you know what I mean? So why aren't they, you know, either coming out from Hollow Earth or why aren't they, you know, just saying, hey, look, enough is enough. We're going to help out.
Reason we're here is because of a lot of the galactic wars that were between these races. So the ones that could really be helpful to us are they don't have a very easy time helping us because, you know, the war is still in a sense going on. But there's some that have high enough and advanced enough ability to be able to, you know, assist us that aren't a part of the galactic wars, but who have come to help us from other universes or who, you know, somehow escaped the major wars and were able to go underground, like the beings, you know, under Talos, you know, that didn't, you know, really get messed with or hybridized with, and they're very pure beings. And they have had representatives come out and try and help us, you know. But the thing is, you know, we have to really, and this is what I'm going to be doing, is really seeking contact with more benevolent forces and really, you know, knowing that this is, you know, how it's going to have to be. And, but first, it's like, we need to build an army of light. We need to, you know, unify the human race. We need to empower humans as leaders. And we need to start to starve our government. I don't think we're going to do very well, you know, juggling both. You know, make a decision. You know, if you're going to go with the government, you all should just get off planet and go somewhere else and have
fun. Yes,
alone and give us our Earth back. If you're going to, you know, choose to be an organic being, you know, you got to trust nature and that you're going to be taken care of and start to ask for help, you know, to these races. It's like asking your immune system to help you if you're sick, but you have to take a step up for your immune system to be activated. It's not going to be activated if you continue eating crappy food or if you're in a low vibration. So we have to take a step up, and if we take a step up and they see that, they're going to want to help us. But if we just ask for help and we're not doing anything and we expect them to do it for us, they're not going to come out because we're not, they're not going to, I mean, they're not being the guardians to, you know, the sacred energies of who we are, and they're not really helping us. We need to fall on our face a little bit and get a clue. And then, you know, once we do, yeah, we're going to get a lot of help, but we got to step it up first because we can't expect somebody to do our dirty work. We got to be, like, you know, really functioning at our best and saying, okay, we're ready for help now. Look at the steps that we've taken to, you know, do everything that we can, and we deserve it, and we're worthy. You know, I'm not saying we're not worthy now, but, you know, it really doesn't help to, you know, just stay in low energy spaces, and, you know, contact is not very easy if there's not a vibratory match. And there's a lot of beings that can make contact and have made contact with higher dimensional races, and they have been helping us. There's motherships all over the place, some that are invisible that you can't see, and some that are hidden by, you know, clouds that, you know, people photograph. They're, you know, called cloud ships. And we're being helped a lot more than we can think, but we have to also understand that this is very difficult for them to work with such a low vibration and a third density planet. You know, being higher dimensional and trying to come in here and help is a pretty challenging experience. And I know a lot of people that are in human bodies that are connected to the mothership, and that's basically, you know, what they're linked to. That's their star family, and they got sent from those ships down here, and they don't know if, you know, they're going to make it, you know, choosing to be on the mission, and not a whole lot of people want to sign up for this sort of stuff. So we have to understand we have all different forms of help beyond, you know, the earthlings that are star seeds, the ships that are connected to them. You know, there's guardian races coming in from other universes that are so incredibly advanced that have been working on the grid for thousands of years. And, you know, we do have more help than we can imagine, but to really activate it and to take it that much further, you know, step it up in your own life, that's going to make them far more interested in helping us on a personal level. We have to know that that's our purpose, to worry about us, to then have that affect everybody else. We can be an example. It doesn't mean that we're just being selfish to us, but we're not going to really help much if we're not, you know, doing everything we can to prepare ourselves for unity consciousness, which is really about finding what our internal truth is. Like I said, it's diversity in harmony, that's oneness. So once we discover our own personal truth, that's a prerequisite for us all unifying, and that includes the benevolent forces of the universe. And so, you know, we just got to do our part, and then the rest will fall into place. You know, instead of being addicted to the matrix, that's where we're in trouble. So get out of that, people, and that's all you really need to do. Which is really quite easy to gain victory at this point right now, but very soon it's going to get more and more difficult. So
real quick, last question. What do you see in 5 years from now? It's 2015. Actually, the magic number would be 10 years. But what do you say?
2025.
Yeah, we can go 2022 if you want. But what do you say?
Well, I mean, I'm not giving in to the fact that we are going to be enslaved, and you know, I was born my mission to keep us from that at all costs. So I can only see the success of my mission and people, you know, that are on similar missions. We're clearly on a similar mission. So I see that timeline. I've been on the positive timeline. I'm upholding the positive timeline just like lots of people. And, you know, I know you are as well. So I see, you know, success and victory. And I see, you know, the dark beings being held accountable.
Anything less than that would pretty much, like you say in the past, we manifest our own reality. So if you focus on something else, right, then it's not going to happen, right?
Well, if it doesn't happen, we have to go through another 26,000-year cycle to get back to the point we're at right now to be able to free ourselves.
So this is it. What you're saying, this is it. It's either now, this is it. It's now or never.
Well, we'll be on another cycle. It doesn't mean the door's going to be closed. We just have to go through it for another 26,000 years.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of different things and theories, you know, connected to that. But, you know, it's really about the choices that we make now, and we have to realize that. And, you know, it's about our DNA, and it's about connecting it to the Earth. And, you know, if we don't make it this time around, you know, we don't know, you know, what we agree to. You know, we might, you know, die in this timeline and manifest into the future or manifest into a parallel Earth, you know. Not every soul is trapped. You know, the ones that are the ones that are programmed, conditioned, and they're the ones that are insulting people like you and me for doing the work we do. You know, wake up, people. You really want to go to a FEMA camp. You know, it's like, that's what's breathing down your neck. And, you know, those that are trying to prevent this from happening are sticking around long enough to try and help the human race. But that's not our timeline. You know, we're going to go back to where we really belong. But we're hanging out long enough to help the human race, you know, join us. And so many, you know, don't really get it, and they're very rude about it. And yes, I have compassion.
Your passion is amazing, and you seem like you get a lot of hate. Do you?
Do I what?
Get a lot of like haters, hate mail, stuff like that.
Everything.
Talk about it. Go ahead.
Comments to stalkers, you know, that won't leave me alone, that want to make my life a living hell. You know, it doesn't really. None of it works. You know, to death threats and just, you know, lots of hatred, and it's just like, you know, you gotta be kidding me. It's like, you know, and I decided to not go off planet so I can help the human race. And going off planet wouldn't have served me anyway, because the whole agenda's been infiltrated, and it's a very dark thing. So, we all have to unify and, like, you know, mature, you know, grow up, people, and step into the best of yourself if you want to be okay, because that's what it's going to take. There's no savior coming to rescue you. But there might be a lot of assistance that comes if you begin to take steps to become a better person, and that creates a vibratory match, and that creates, you know, the law of attraction. The people that are on the ground, you know, trying to wake you up while you're being a jerk, you know, you've got that, but to get to the next level of the ones that are beyond those that are in human form, if you ever want to get to them, you better stop, you know, doing what you're doing that's keeping you very compromised.
Well, what happens to them? They're just recycled again?
Well, they are the ones that are most affected by nanoparticles and the chemtrails that are linking them to an artificial intelligence system, which means they're easily mind controlled, which means that they lose connection to their soul.
And their spirit, right.
Yeah, but people like us, we're kind of immune to it because we're so connected to our soul that nothing is going to control us or kick us away from it.
They would do best
if they could just, you know, learn a little bit from us and understand that we're all equals, but, you know, get away from, you know, those that are really harming you, and make sure you don't have implants and check yourself. And be
well, how do you do that? How do you make sure you don't have implants?
There's people that, if anybody wants to contact me, I can connect you with that does that. That's their work. And
well, can you say, are you allowed to say who they are now or no?
I have to ask first because they don't have a website. But you can contact me and I can, you know, link you. But yeah, his rates are very good. They're sliding scale, very, very good rates. And the thing is, if we all take responsibility and check ourselves, then we're not a part of, you know, the problem. They're trying to turn us into weapons against each other. So the best thing we can do then is to make sure that we are not becoming that. And if we clear ourselves from it, then we have basically succeeded in overriding that technological attack on a grand scale. And then, you know, there's other things, which is, you know, taking good care of ourselves and keeping our vibration high just in other ways, you know, and recognizing the importance of relationships, you know, and just honoring those things and the sacred energies of life. I mean, there's so much to share on that, but, you know, I know the show is pretty much closing, but, you know, people, you can reach out to me, you can write, I do consultations. My rates are pretty fair. I can help link you to people that will help you to make sure that you're prepared for the future. And if each of us does that, we're in great shape because the tipping point will be reached. And then divine justice will happen because they'll experience a major backlash before they succeed in New World Order.
And again, this is the great Laura Eisenhower. Thank you so much for the interview.
Well, thank you so much for having me. And we'll connect hopefully again. And thanks, everybody, for listening.
All right, 1 second.